Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. In New York, call 877-8-HOPE-NY or text HOPE-NY, that's 467-369. In Connecticut, help is available for problem gambling. Call 888-789-7777 or visit ccpg.org. Please play responsibly on behalf of Boot Hill Casino and Resort in Kansas. 21 plus age and eligibility varies by jurisdiction. Void in New Hampshire, Oregon, and Ontario. Bonus bets expire 168 hours after issuance. For additional terms and responsible gaming resources, see dkng.co/football.
All right, everyone, welcome again to Bear Bets, presented by DraftKings Sportsbook. DraftKings Sportsbook is the number one place to bet touchdowns this season. And this week, new customers can bet $5 and get $150 in bonus bets if your first bet wins. Download the DK Sportsbook app, use the promo code BEARBETS, that's BEARBETS, two words, when you sign up. DraftKings Sportsbook, the crown is yours. And what is ours, Geoff Schwartz, myself, Sammy P. Will Hill, a little time slot here on FS1 to kick around Bear Bets Podcast Championship Weekend. Proud to and happy and excited to be on FS1. Everyone, welcome to the world of real TV as opposed to just in the digital land. So fun to be on TV here.
Yeah, good to spread our fun little podcast, right? We try to get everyone winners, Bear, of course. We have a lot of fun doing it. We talk college football. We'll do NFL, of course, as well. We'll give you some FCS plays, and we'll have a lot of fun busting each other's butts behind the scenes as well. So glad to be with everyone on FS1, Bear. And we have a lot to get to this week.
And glad you you wore the sweet Oregon hockey jersey as well. No
bias whatsoever.
Would have been more fitting for the debut here on FS1 than Jersey Geoff.
If we keep winning, buddy, I'm going to keep wearing it. So get ready for this.
You should.
It's away all the way till January 20th. Every single time we're doing this show together, as long as we keep winning, buddy.
We got to get like a playoff beard out of you as well.
I could do that. Yeah. I mean, no one cares. No one's listening to this show or watching it for my appearance. So it does not matter what I look like.
Correct.
So we keep the beard, keep the beard extra long. Playoff beard, you know, might be nice. I might do that. Then, you know, for the diet green and yellow or something too, to match the hockey jersey. Yeah.
But what people do want, they want winners, as you mentioned. And I think the college football playoff seeding scenario, you could bet these seeds in a few places, and kicking this around, I think obviously if both favorites win, would be meaning Oregon and Texas, we know Oregon will be the number one seed. But I think the interesting question will be who will be the five seed. I think most people just assume that Notre Dame would be the five seed because they are ranked the highest of all those teams right now. And everything that Ward Manuel mentioned yesterday about teams not playing, really don't have any data points to be able to move up because they're not playing. But I wonder, like, that will cause an entire reshuffling of like those top six teams and the way the voting goes down in clusters. Like, Notre Dame probably would be the five seed because they're the highest ranked teams of the. That would mean Georgia will have lost and fallen down. That means Penn State will have lost and fallen down. So like you'd be stuck with the five seed down into trying to determine Notre Dame, who has the one win over Army, which might not even be a ranked win come Saturday night. If Army were to lose that conference title game against Tulane, they may have no wins.
Yeah.
They have a home loss against a 4-4 MAC team. You compare that to Ohio State, who's not playing as well this weekend. You came off of a loss at home against Michigan. Your other loss is a 1-point loss in Eugene against the number one ranked team in the country. And you've got a win over Penn State, who just played for the Big Ten Championship. You've got a win over Indiana, who is another top 10 team and a playoff team. You look at the efficiency metrics and the strength of schedule and all that. Ohio State would have a very strong case to be the five seed, and I'd be curious to see what type of odds there are on being the number five seed. I think they would probably err on the side of least resistance with Notre Dame, but I think Ohio State would have a very strong case at being the five seed if both Oregon and Texas win on Saturday.
The committee has said they will not punish teams for playing conference championship games, right, Bear? So if it's a close loss for Penn State, a close loss for even Texas, right? Like, I know we're talking favorites here. I think one of those teams is probably at 5 over Notre Dame, who's not playing this weekend. And Ohio State being 5, Bear, look, I get it. 10-2, had a great season. But you give them the 5 seed after losing to Michigan as a 21-point favorite, right. 20-point favorite, and then get to play Arizona State and Boise State while other teams have tougher schedules. I just don't see that happening. I know they're not supposed to put the emotions into choosing where teams are at and not favor certain matchups, but they're humans. They watch the games. They know what matchups should be in there and what the narrative is. If you give Ohio State the 5 seed, it almost completely invalidates the entire point of this whole process, which, by the way, conference championship games will be gone in 2 years. They won't be here anymore. But you have said that these games should not matter. Sorry, SMU, close your ears, for seeding. And so if you're Penn State and you lose by 3 points, why is Notre Dame ahead of you with the schedule they had versus the schedule you had? So I think it's either Penn State or Texas if they lose. Or Oregon, obviously, if Oregon loses, they're 5. So I just don't think it's Notre Dame. I don't think it's Ohio State.
Yeah, it's basically a free roll. It's like extra credit. If you get it, great. If you don't, it really shouldn't be able to hurt you. But I think that's the way we're setting up here. And the other great debate that at some point will be had somewhere on the air is what happens if both dogs win? What happens if Georgia wins and Penn State wins? Who gets the number one? I think we all think it might be Penn State, but Georgia would have a very good case too.
It probably is Penn State.
It will. They'll take it. They'll take the path of least resistance. Yeah. But if you examine the wins,
I'm with you.
Georgia would have a very good, very, very, very good case.
Yes.
In doing that. Time now for what is our favorite portion of the show, the Gambling Group Chat. Geoff and I, joined by Sammy P and Will Hill, kick around more of these SEC and ACC conference title games and a bunch more. Enjoy. Gambling Group Chat time. Once again, myself and Geoff Schwartz, joined by Sammy P and Will Hill, as we always are on the College Football Chat. Championship weekend is here, and the number one ranked team in the country, the Big Ten newcomers, the Oregon Ducks, wearing the proud jersey, Geoff, hockey jersey that we talked about so much last week. What a great look that was. Going to Indianapolis and taking on Penn State. I think we all thought this was going to be a 1-2 Oregon-Ohio State rematch. However, it is the Nittany Lions that are now in Indianapolis. Oregon, a 3.5-point favorite, total 49.5. And this is our Super 6 game of the week, presented by DraftKings Sportsbook. We'll have that column coming out later in the week. We're going to break it down here. Obviously, one of the questions will be, what will the outcome be in the Big Ten championship game? I don't know about you guys. I see this as a lower scoring type game. I don't know how many points Penn State is going to be able to score on this Oregon defense. You go back and look at the last 6 top 10 teams that Penn State has played. They have scored either 0 or 1 offensive touchdown in 4 of them. Of course, they've lost 13 straight top 10 teams prior to a bowl game against a top 10 team. So, feels like a spot where it's going to be a lot of people going Oregon or pass here. Would you agree, Sammy P?
No doubt. James Franklin in a big game. That's the narrative. My power ratings have Oregon 5 points better. The number's 3.5. So I have an edge, I believe. That said, I usually don't become Mr. Chalk, especially in postseason games. DraftKings has Oregon -170. I was betting everything I could find on Jake Paul -190 a couple weeks ago. You're telling me that the prices are similar, Will? Jake Paul was -190. I can bet against James Franklin at -170. I avoid the 10-point lead and the backdoor touchdown. Does anybody here really like Penn State to win the game? I don't.
I have extensive notes here on Oregon versus Ohio State. I don't know what to do with them. I had a little too much turkey on Thanksgiving. I slept. I woke up, and that's not the game. What happened to Ohio State? Where are they? I thought they were supposed to be here. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I think the key matchup for me in this game, I don't like Penn State's O-line. I think Oregon control the game from that perspective. So, you know, Penn State team total under, Oregon laying the points. It does, and I usually don't think like this, it does look a little too good to be true, where, you know, if you go to a bar, 10 people betting on this game, 9 of them are going to say, Oregon's undefeated, they're only laying 3.5, I'll lay it here. It'd be a lean to Oregon. Nothing I've gotten in the account yet, Geoff.
they're going to lean that way because of what we talked about with James Franklin. I'm going to lean that way because of what I watched on the film and what we know about Penn State. And Bear mentioned it, right? When they play better defenses, they do not score. Oregon's defense is really good, and we'll talk about their team total a little bit later. But let's go to Penn State's offense, guys. They played two defenses this year in the top 15 of efficiency. Minnesota, oddly enough, is 14. Ohio State is 1. They were 4 of 22 on third down those games and did not score the ball. No, it's actually – no, I don't think it's very good, Bear. And because they don't generate explosive plays, right? Warren does, but the way they get their tight end open is they have to sort of scheme it up. It's not like a Brock Bowers. You just line up on one side, clear everyone out, and have them go run the ball. It's screened. It's moving them around a bunch. So I think Oregon's prepared for this game. Also worth noting, Oregon's offense has played two defenses similar to Penn State. Now, Penn State does things differently. They have individual pass rushers that are very good. They move a lot, but they play a ton of man coverage, which leads into Oregon's ability to go deep in these games. Oregon scored 32 against Ohio State, the most points Ohio State allowed this season. They scored 38 against Michigan, the most points Michigan has allowed this season. So Oregon is tested against these type of defenses. I think Oregon does win this game, Bear, but I do think it could go under because Penn State doesn't score a lot.
Yeah, I was going to say, it sounds like we are all kind of in agreement here, a lower scoring game, and we do like Oregon to maintain that number one seed entering the college football playoff. Now to the original, the OG of conference championship games, the SEC, Georgia and Texas. Looked like a long shot that Georgia would be in this game. However, they got a chain of events that has Kirby Smart and the Bulldogs here, whether they like it or not. In a regular season rematch against Texas, Longhorns, a 2.5-point favorite, down from what was that, 5.5, 6, I believe, in the earlier season meeting in Austin. That was a weird game down in Austin, first meeting. 7 combined turnovers. You had that weird penalty and the reversal. And, oh, by the way, it wasn't PI, and Texas got the ball. Quinn Ewers was pulled for Arch Manning. Texas had 7 drives start inside their own 20, 4 inside their 15. So field position was a big factor in that game. The Georgia defensive line played lights out. Texas's running backs had 50 yards rushing, I think it was, in the game, 7 sacks. And now you got to wonder, they struggled that night. We don't know if Banks, the offensive tackle, one of the best in the country, if he's going to play. I think they feel okay if Goolsby plays, but I like Georgia here in this game again. Yeah, it's essentially a home game, but Texas will have a lot of people there. I just am a little bit concerned about that offensive line going against Georgia's defensive front in that building. I don't know if Texas can reverse the first meeting in Austin. I took Georgia plus 2.5. I took a little Georgia money line as well. Will, what are you thinking here?
Makes me feel better because I kind of have the same view of the game. I like, above anything else, the under for a lot of the reasons you outlined, where Beck turned it over 3 times the first matchup. Ewers turned it over 3 times, an interception and 2 fumbles. I think both coaches come into this game and say, hey, before we can win it, let's not lose it. Let's not turn it over. Let's be a little conservative. 49.5 is a lot of points. And either offense sniffed 300 yards. I mean, you're talking about a college game where both offenses are in the 200s. Texas had like 250, 3.4 yards per play. I know that's a stat you like for Texas. Georgia wasn't much better. You know, from a prop standpoint, do we see Arch Manning at some point as a little change up, a little change of pace? We saw him in the first meeting. So I lean towards Georgia. I prefer Sarkisian. I prefer Smart to Sarkisian, especially in a matchup in terms of like adjustments, things like that. You're getting points with Georgia, which... I'm worried sometimes we're hypnotized by the uniform, but I do like the under. And look, if you watch the NFL on Sunday, you see Brock Bowers, you see McConkey. Oof. Those guys are really good. Those guys haven't really been replaced by Georgia, so they struggled to get the explosive play. So to me, you know, an ugly 23-20, maybe even a 2017 game. I know that's low scoring for college, but Sammy, to me, it's under or nothing. I lead towards Georgia here.
Biggest issue in the game for me is Texas's left tackle not being available. That's a huge deal against a Georgia D line that is going to bring pressure. And the blueprint is there. We've already seen this game. We saw the adjustments in the second half that Georgia made when they had to go to Austin and shut it down in half number 2. And look, guys, Georgia's not been a great cover team this year. They've been up, they've been down, but this is a resilient team. Coming back multiple times this season, rallying back in the game, even though they lost against Alabama, a lesser team quits and does not fight back from down 4 scores. It's a glorified home game. This team has been in this building time and time and time again. Geoff, I give Texas a whole lot of credit for getting to the SEC title game in year number 1. Remember, they were not supposed to get here, but from a power rating standpoint, I've got Georgia at a 127.5 and Texas at a 128. I do not think this is 2.5 on the point spread.
Let's sort of talk about Texas first, guys, and sort of what they've been since that Georgia game. They decided to run the football, right? They said, we're not going to have the same game plan against Georgia, and then running the football has done well for them. But still, it's led to less points, guys. They've underperformed up to expectations offensively in most of their conference games, like well under 10 points, 12 points, 14 points under expectations because they run the ball now. And Quinn Ewers is very inconsistent. And when there's pressure on his face, when he feels uncomfortable, he's not as good now. When he's on, he is on. He made a great throw early in that game last weekend. Like, he can make some great throws still. And on the flip side, Georgia's offense can't run the football. It's been a problem theirs all season. So they put more on Carson Beck. But you put more on Carson Beck to the point that I think Will made, you don't have those wide receivers and tight ends anymore, so you're not as good. So to me, this is a low-scoring game. It screams low-scoring, which means I think any team can win depending on the mistakes on either side, right? If Quinn Ewers makes no mistakes, Texas wins. If Carson Beck makes no mistakes, Georgia probably wins. I think this game is supremely under. Like, I think it's an under game. 2017, both teams want to run the football, even though Georgia can't, keep away from their team, and let their defensive special teams try to control most of the tempo for Saturday night.
Yeah, well, one of the things we talked about was just how scheduling was going to matter this year. And if you look at the SEC and you look at Texas, excluding Texas, six teams in the SEC won at least nine games. Texas faced only one of them.
Yeah.
And that was at home against Georgia, when they lost by 15 points on their home field. So I still think there's a little bit of a question as to how good this Texas offense is, especially. And I think there's going to be questions as we move on to the ACC as well. I think the committee had their tell on a Tuesday night when post-ranking show where Emanuel basically goes, oh, is there a chance that SMU could fall behind Alabama if they lose? And he said, absolutely. I think that's all you needed to hear. I think we all see how this is playing out here with SMU now a 2.5-point favorite over Clemson in this game. SMU has not faced a very difficult schedule as well. They played five of their eight conference games against teams that had a losing ACC record. They lost to BYU. I know they've been really good since Jennings came in, but again, we talked about the ACC game being basically a home game for the SEC game being a home game for Georgia. The ACC game in Charlotte is essentially a home game for Clemson. I like Clemson in the game. Again, plus 2.5 on the money line. Their defense played pretty well last week outside of Sellers making a couple of great plays. I'm not sure Jennings is going to be that physical of a player like Sellers was last week. So I do like Klubnik to make some big plays through the air. And I like Clemson. And unfortunately, I think we're going to be looking at Alabama surpassing SMU. Look, if you want to say Alabama is a better team, that's fine. A lot of the metrics kind of indicate that they are. But the way the committee's going about doing this, it looks like if they could just like club SMU right now and say, yeah, you're going to be out, they would probably go ahead and do this, Jeff.
Yeah, they would. And they telegraphed it. They said what they're going to do. So we know sort of how this plays out. My thing with SMU in this game is you have not played this type of athlete yet this season. I mean, I'm looking at the schedule now. Cal, Virginia, BC, Pitt, Duke, Stanford, Louisville, Florida State, TCU, non-conference BYU. You haven't played a Clemson. Now, I understand Clemson has a lot of problems and they're inconsistent in offense. But Will, I think like just body style, right? Physicality. SMU has not played in these games before. Clemson has played in this game. I'm not worried so much about the home crowd, Bear. This game is in Charlotte. I don't know how many Clemson fans are going to care for losing to South Carolina. And there is some of that factor, I think, of Clemson, how they're going to emotionally play after thinking they're out of this thing last weekend. I understand that, but that was a big loss last weekend, right? You lost your rival in your own home stadium. And that was probably felt like a morgue afterwards in the locker room. And then you realize, oh shoot, we have to play again on Saturday. It's a little different than Penn State, who won big and then announced after the game, we're playing on Saturday. So Will, I think just physicality and the body structure and style of what Clemson is will overwhelm SMU over four quarters.
First off, you guys both know I have SMU 16-1 to win the ACC. So you're both haters. You're both just rooting against
our pick. That's clearly what we're doing.
I would have loved to seen Clemson. I wonder if they were watching Miami-Syracuse together as a team. Jeff, you would know how that goes as a player. I would love to see like a Clemson cam when Miami lines up to kick that field goal to cut it to four, turn it from a one-score game to a one-score game. Of course, they never see the ball back. Sorry to open wounds here, Bear.
That's quite all right.
Bear bet on Syracuse.
I actually think Clemson's the right side here. How about this, though? I mean, people, you always hear this. We got friends that say this that are, you know, somewhat familiar with betting. Vegas always knows. Vegas opened this SMU getting 3. I don't know if they thought Clemson was hosting the game. That's a pretty big error, pretty big correction, because we saw this go from Clemson laying 3 to getting 2.5 like within a blink Sunday morning. So that clearly wasn't the right line. Are you going to get a 3 here with Clemson? Maybe. I always think, hey, why take 2.5? If it goes to 2, who cares? If it goes to 3, that's a big difference. But for a lot of the reasons you guys mentioned, just the pedigree of Clemson, they're used to being here. SMU not really tested. It's funny. Maybe I'm just handicapping, again, the jerseys too much, because if you look on the field, SMU's got real talent both sides of the ball. There are some common opponents that
SMU. A lot of ex-Miami players on that team.
Yeah, and there's some common opponents that SMU has blown out, like Pittsburgh that Clemson struggled with Pitt. SMU destroyed them. There's a couple games like that. I think it's probably a field goal game. I lean towards SMU winning, but I think this is more of like a toss-up game here, Sammy. I don't know that laying points with either side is the right way to go.
Sammy, I'm just mad that my SMU plus 3.5 hypothetical matchup versus Miami bet got voided. I would have loved to have had that this week for going all favorite against Miami, and I'm getting 3.5.
Well, Bear, you know that I'm very sorry that happened to you. And if it's a field goal game, let's just make it 33-30. I think this total is about a touchdown too low. You're going to see points. This will not be the rock fight that South Carolina brought to the table. Both teams can move the football in this game. 55.5 right now at DraftKings. I'm over.
I like it.
A lot of people liking the over as well. Points expected in Arlington. Arizona State, who was picked last in the Big 12, taking on Iowa State, who was a team that we had talked about before the year. 10-2 versus 10-2 Arizona State, -2 total of 51. A lot of great receiver play on the field. Obviously, Cam Scadaboo, the best running back, one of the best running backs in the country. I thought he was worthy of being entered for the Doak Walker Award, but a lot of people in Iowa and Chapel Hill disagreed with me. However, I kind of like Iowa State here, though. I trust their defense a little bit more. 3-3-5 that John Hickok runs. I think they can stop teams. And I just wonder the physicality that Arizona State might face here. You kind of go down their schedule. I don't think they've exactly faced the murderer's row of defenses. Now, look, they've got some wins, and they have been impressive, and they have surprised everyone. But I don't know about you, Will, but I do like Iowa State here at getting 2. However, holding the Iowa State futures, if I do anything, it might just be a little bit of a money line on ASU to kind of at least guarantee a little bit of a profit based on the nice 10-1 that we got in the preseason.
Yeah, it's a nice ticket. And man, it's just, it feels like a missed opportunity. Maybe next year, hopefully next year, we can like start doing some of these previews earlier, because I think in the new NIL, the transfer portal, they're going to be some of these, like Arizona State was 130-1 to win the Big 12. I thought I was, you know, you had a long shot. I thought I had a long shot with Colorado middle of the season at 14-1. Mm-hmm. Apparently we didn't go further enough down the board. Arizona State in October was like 75-1. So again, there's just so much variance, so much uncertainty with these teams, with these players switching teams. I think this line's about right. I would lean towards Arizona State, first of all, because you're rooting against my SMU. I'm just going to root against your Iowa State.
Clearly.
But I just think the trio of Scadaboo, Levitt, the coach, Dillingham, who's done a tremendous job. I don't trust Becht. I think he can be a little, you know, daring, a little dangerous with the ball here. Jeff, I know.
Yeah.
Look, we all have winners and losers. I think a bunch of people like Arizona State under. I don't remember if you were one of those.
Oh, I was. Thank you.
Sammy told me he'd give me $20 if I mentioned it. So there you go.
I had two of those wagers.
Jeff.
Yeah.
Jeff, does Dillingham go to Oregon when Lanning goes to Columbus and replaces Ryan Day?
Oh, boy.
I think that we're on network TV, so I will not stick up the fingers I would like to. And just, I will not talk about
kidding.
I will not talk about
completely kidding.
I know you are,
Bear. Don't go crazy, Columbus. I'm completely kidding.
I know you are. I'll be Kenny Dillingham at the end of that game. Just start yelling at everyone on the field. Look, here's my problem in this game with Iowa State. They do two things that I think hurt them in this matchup. They do not stop the run. They're near 100th in the country in yards per rush, which against Cam Scadaboo and that offense, you don't want to be, right? Because Arizona State primarily wants to run the football. And two, they don't really pressure the quarterback. So you can't stop the run and can't pressure the quarterback. Now, I'm not sure Arizona State's defense is that much better at doing those things than Iowa State is. But that does worry me. If you're down 3-7 points, Sammy, in the fourth quarter, how are you going to come back if Arizona State just runs the ball 12 times in a row, right? And so that's my concern here. I would lean Arizona State. not my strongest feel. Fun game to watch. I'm rooting for Kenny Dillingham. But I that Iowa State defense worries me when stopping the run and rushing the passer.
I'm so torn on this game. I probably won't make a bet. I'll have plenty of bets this weekend in college football. This one won't be one that makes the card. I will say, though, we did a video on the morning show at BetQL that somehow had 500,000 views on Instagram. I don't know how it happened. It just
humble
hit lightning in a bottle. We posted it last Wednesday when Ohio State was supposed to play Arizona State and then play Boise. So I'm on this video saying that Ohio State would beat Arizona State by 3-4 touchdowns. And Arizona State people have gotten a hold of this.
Oh, boy.
Oh, this nerd doesn't watch football. This guy doesn't know anything, blah, blah, blah. Let me just give you an idea of how Arizona State does not belong in this playoff. Here are the teams that have higher power ratings than Arizona State. Just for the record, Kentucky, Kansas, Michigan, Auburn, Florida, TCU, Oklahoma, Arkansas. It's not personal, or at least it wasn't personal, but now it's personal. I want Arizona State to lose this game. I want them out of the playoff.
That's Sammy P. That's not Will Hill. That's not Geoff Schwartz. That's not Chris Leica. You know what's funny, too? Remember last year doing these podcasts, Arizona State was like our little pet team. I bet on them a lot, and I was getting like 34.5, 35.5 against USC. You turn around a year later, you blink, and they're in the title game. It's just crazy. That's Sammy P, by the way. He was trashing Arizona State.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, you look at some of their numbers. They are 72nd strength of schedule, 16th strength of record, defensive efficiency outside the top 30. Yeah, it feels statistically like they are an outlier.
Houston almost got Colorado in the game, too. I don't know if you guys were up. That was a late game, but they were up 7-0. They tried to get cute with the onside kick. It's funny because, like I said, I had Colorado futures. I just went to put in a little bit of a hedge, a pretty decent hedge on BYU money line, and it went from like minus 170 to minus 330. Oh, what the hell happened?
Something happened.
I guess during the game, because our buddy Stormy Bonantoni was the sideline reporter, I guess the touchdown occurred during a studio update, which, I mean, it's 2024. Do we really need the studio update? So I don't even know if
with no other games going on.
Yeah, Houston had their chances to put Colorado in. Brutal.
I mean,
they did.
There was a game the other night in the NFL where they missed a whole punt because they were a commercial break. So, I mean, I guess it does happen.
It does. You mentioned Stormy, who has covered a lot of Mountain West games as well. Boise State, that's where I will be with Big Noon Kickoff on Friday afternoon. Mountain, I think 4 p.m. Preview show, 5 p.m. kick. Regular season rematch of the Broncos, -4, total of 58. Obviously, the Broncos have not been nearly as impressive lately as they were earlier in the year. Rematch of the regular season game where, well, we were talking about this earlier, how Boise was a 4-point favorite at UNLV back when they played in late October, it was. And that was a game that was clearly there for UNLV to win. A couple of crucial penalties on the final drive, turnover right before halftime. The game was there. They did a bunch of things to really give Boise State an opportunity to get in this game. They're the only team really that really slowed Ashton Gentry down this year. It feels like a lot of people are making an argument for UNLV to go on the road here and win. I certainly give them a chance, but it feels like one of those underdogs with fleas here where people are kind of reacting to that first meeting and the fact that UNLV easily could have won. Weather does not appear like it will be an issue. It looks like it's going to be right around 40, no rain, no snow. So it looks like it'll be just a cool night. I don't think that's really going to affect the team one way or another. Geoff, I know we've had some thoughts about Boise lately, and I know that Oregon State game last week, we really had no idea how Boise was going to play it. I'm going to pass on it. If I'm in one of those pick'em pools, I would probably lay the 4 with Boise. But again, like Sammy wasn't going to bet the Big 12, I'm not going to bet this one. I'll be there. I'll enjoy it. And clearly, if Boise wins the game, they will be getting a first-round bye college football playoff.
So when UCLA and USC, which are warm weather schools, go and play in the Pacific Northwest or in the mountain states in November, I just fade them every time. because they never win those games, never cover. It's hard when you are in a warm weather city to go play in the cold, even if the weather bear is not miserable. It is still as cold in Boise on a Friday night. And this sort of has the same handicap here. It's nothing crazy, but guys, these teams do not go from warmth to cold and win and cover very often, especially against a very physical Boise State rushing attack. That the Boise State offense has not performed up to task in three of their last four games. We know that. But they still have the best running back in the country who makes a lot of people miss, Sammy. And I would lean Boise State here. Not a play right now. I do think there's some live wagering opportunities here. If UNLV scores early, goes up 7-0, there might be a Boise State money line price here and vice versa. Boise State scores early, get UNLV plus a touchdown. So I think the live wagering is the way to do this. But I do worry about those warm weather teams going to play in the cold. It does not end well a lot of times for those teams.
Usually for the offense, too. That's usually the bugaboo. Now, wind will not be a factor at kickoff, at least as of right now. But 27 degrees, guys, is the low in Boise on Friday. 27 degrees. Not ideal for offense, usually. And the one thing you have to pay attention to, not only with UNLV, but with Tulane, think about their head coaches. And there are now four jobs in this country that are open. Purdue's open. UCF is open. North Carolina's open. West Virginia's open.
If Purdue's you don't open? Think Purdue fire their head coach?
Purdue, I'm being told Purdue is open. Yes, Purdue is open. I also saw on Purdue Reddit that if Purdue had a 30-point lead in all of its games coming into the game, they would have finished 6-6. How about that? That's very interesting. But if you don't think Barry Odom and John Sumrall and their camps are in conversations with these big openings, you are not paying attention. So that's always something good to consider when you look at these mid-major teams, not mid-majors, but group of five teams in college football. When they have big games, whether it be a conference title game or a bowl game, you know there are conversations happening behind the scenes. And that always makes me wonder, are they focused? Are they 100% in for these games? And I don't have that answer at this point in time.
It's also
in a lot of instances, too, coordinators. Yes, I believe Andy Koltunicki was mentioned, interviewed for the open West Virginia job. Does that come into effect? Like as a player, Geoff, like, do you get wind of this? Do you hear it? Have you ever, like, gotten a sense that, like, one of your coordinators or one of your assistants, like, weren't really all in? I think Marcus Arroyo might be up for some jobs, too, at Arizona State.
Well, so I think Marion is being courted by Utah, who's UNLV's OC right now, because Utah obviously is trying to find themselves a new OC. It's a good point you made, Bear and Sammy, because, you know, look, we went through this at Oregon a couple years ago with Mario leaving, right? There were rumors about Miami, and I kept saying it wasn't going to affect the team, wasn't going to affect the team, and it did. And you talked to those guys in the locker room, and they heard those whispers, they heard those rumors, and the team kind of stunk the last month of the season as those rumors. We see that, by the way, happen everywhere. And I don't think that anyone tries less hard, like Andy Koltunicki this weekend for Penn State. He's not trying any less hard. He's not preparing any differently, but he is spending, if it's a real interview, he's spending hours, right, putting together a notebook to share to North Carolina or West Virginia. Here's my plan, guys. He's spending a little extra time, right, staying up late at night, detailing the staff that he put together, the kids he'd want to recruit. Because if he gets that job immediately after Saturday, like, they have to recruiting sign day is actually today, but transfer portal window, more recruits. Like, so you're not thinking 100% about the job you currently have. And again, I'm not saying that any of these coaches preparing differently or try less or try more. Like, they're prepared to play, but the players know this, the coaches know this, everyone around them knows it. And I think it just has a little bit different feel in those locker rooms when coaches are applying for other jobs. And by the way, coaches should do this. They absolutely should go ahead and find different jobs and better jobs. No problem in doing that. But we see a lot of examples where coaches are talking to other teams and then just not quite as buttoned up on game day after that news comes out.
And the other one of the other coaches you just mentioned, John Sumrall, Tulane, bad home loss Thanksgiving night to really eliminate them from any college football playoff contention, losing to Memphis. However, now they have to go on the road as a result of that loss, and they go to West Point, and they're going to take on Army. They are a 4.5-point road favorite. This number got bet up, I think I saw, to 6. Is this the old Dipsy Doo Dunkaroo, a little bit of a false move to drive it up to have people come in on Army, Sammy?
Could be, although Sumrall's been very good. Small sample size, 3 games against the option. His defense has only allowed 9 points. I saw Brad Powers tweet that the other day. That's pretty solid. Not a big sample size, but 3 games, 9 total points. Summerall knows how to at least negate or slow
running game.
The option. That's always something you account for. We could have some okie doke here. This opened 4 in Vegas, got bet all the way to 6, and it was a slow build. It was 4 to 4.5 to 5 to 5.5 to 6. But once it hit 6, pow, big bets on Army at +6. So now we're looking. Market's mostly 4.5. DraftKings has 4.5. It's tough to bet against Army. They're so disciplined. They don't make mistakes. My only concern, Will, is Bryson Daly anywhere near, forget 100, because nobody's 100. I'm not 100, and 80. I don't play football. Where's Bryson Daly's health at? Exactly. Is he ready to go? Yes. Can he do all the things he needs to do to execute the big plays? That's my concern. I lean under in the game, and that under got whacked too. You can still go under 46. Man, this feels like a 21-20, 17-14 type final score. So I like the under in the game.
Agree with the under. I like Tulane here. I just think, and you kind of stole my thunder there, and I don't know if that Brad Powers nugget factors in the two games when Summerall was at Troy. And it was 10-9, 19-0. Yeah, so that was one I thought was a good nugget that wasn't going to be stolen. But that was a good point that you brought up. And look, I just think Tulane, they've got good linebackers. They got a couple, borderline wide receivers in terms of like NFL guys. To me, Tulane's just the more well-balanced team. That was just a terrible performance Thanksgiving. And I'm sure most people were either, with their families or watching the NFL game. But man, that was disappointing, Bear, because we had a chance to get them in the playoff. But I like Tulane in the game. I do have a little concern. You're talking about, Jeff's point here of a team from New Orleans going to play cold weather. That's going to be a raucous environment. But I think Tulane is just the better team. I think they win this game by a touchdown or so. You guys all glossed over something. Sammy P admitted on this show on live TV that he spends his idle time here on Reddit, Purdue Reddit. What are we doing? We need to get you some hobbies, some better things to do with your time. Purdue Reddit is what you're doing with your days when we get done with these shows. Come on.
I have scrapers that clip it and send it to me.
Okay.
And scrolling.
How do we get on the Sammy P payroll?
I frequent message boards every now and then for college football. I'm not going to lie. A day like today, signing day, it's fun to go look at a USC message board, Washington message board. I dabble in those guys. I don't do Reddit as much, but some good information on Reddit as well. I'm with you, Sammy. It's okay. Don't be ashamed that you frequent those as I do as well. So don't be ashamed of that. Quickly, guys, Tulane did play Navy this year without the starting quarterback. So I don't know if you want to include that game in the stat about how they don't allow points to these rushing offense. I want to give a shout out quickly to Army, Joe Moore Award finalist for the three teams, Army, Oregon, Texas, all three playing this weekend. Pretty big honor for Army to be included for the Joe Moore Award. Best offense in the country. That's the award, by the way. We will vote on it this week. And good for Army. I still think Tulane wins the game, but fun for Army to be included because they've earned it. The offensive line gets after it. It'll be a fun matchup to watch this weekend.
Gee, I Jeff's voting. I wonder who Jeff's going to vote for.
Oregon's offensive line has played really well. And Oregon's offensive line will probably get my vote because pass protection matters. And Oregon's offensive line is very good at pass protection. I'm excited to be a part of this award, obviously. So we have three great finalists. I will not reveal who I will vote for. Actually, I probably will at the end of the week. I'll let you guys know. Let me next week.
Yeah, you mentioned like the Sammy P going to the Purdue Reddit looking for notes. Right. That's like a great feature. Whether it's a Bruce Feldman and Andy Staples and Stuart Mandel or Wright Thompson, whoever, in the offseason to do a little Tom Rinaldi.
Wright Thompson, Tom Rinaldi.
Cottage industry of how far people will go to get information, posing as burner Twitter accounts and DMing quarterbacks to see if they're going to play or win a job, all these burner accounts that are out there. That'd be a pretty fun lighthearted investigative piece.
Bear, should know better. You don't message the quarterback. You message the quarterback's girlfriend. That's what you do.
Here's what led me to this. Will and I know someone who he created a bunch of burner accounts, and it would be an attractive female, and he would DM a quarterback at a school where either he was hurt or is he going to be the starting quarterback at the end of the year? and, hey, I'd love to come see you play this week. Are you going to be playing? And that's how they would go about getting information.
And this worked? This actually worked?
Yes. Yes.
Wow.
Yep. I'm not going to mention the player involved, and I'm not going to mention the school, but he did wind up being able to win a bet on who will take the first snap at quarterback, win the starting quarterback job for a certain school based on this person saying that blank would be starting and not me.
Geoff, you played in the wrong era, buddy. I'm sorry. You missed it by about 10 years.
I did. I mean, Facebook came my spring of my freshman season, but it wasn't obviously when I wasn't getting hit up by fake profiles asking if I was starting or not. So, wow. I did not realize people went to that length, Bear, to get to that information.
Bear, I think that trumps, you know, our buddy Jason Weingarten, who's a big bettor. Remember there was a prop a few years ago in the Super Bowl, how many Jets will be on the flyover? And he knew somebody at the White House, and he's calling the White House trying to win a prop bet on the flyover. So, hey, whatever it takes to get in that win column.
Oh, there's a blue Gatorade, too, the Tampa-Kansas City Super Bowl. If you wanted to bet Tampa Bay, you could have taken them on the money line at plus 130. There was a kid from the south side of Chicago on the sideline who was telling everybody that the Gatorade was blue. So if you wanted to bet the Bucks, you could bet the Bucks money line plus 130 or the Gatorade at 8-1. It's a no-brainer at that point. The Bucks win the game. KC had two tackles that were hurt. Bucks win the game. Bucks dump blue Gatorade.
Yeah. I might have known someone in the Justin Timberlake camp a couple of years ago, too, that was able to help with a couple of halftime props as well. So information is awesome. We love it. Anybody got any information on the MAC title game? Miami of Ohio pulled the upset at Bowling Green last week. We talked about that. Ohio U with the big win to get in the game, and they got the result. They got Miami of Ohio to upset BG. I know a few of us here did have some BG futures that went up in smoke, but a really interesting, tight game. Miami of Ohio's defense has been playing really, really well. It has been a long time since Ohio U won a MAC title. They as good as they were in the Solich era, as good as they were with Rourke at quarterback, and had some other really good years as well. Like, they haven't won a MAC title, I think, in like 50 years. So it's been a while. The first regular season, like Ohio, what was it? I think it was 30-20, like the first meeting this year. I can't remember if Ohio won the game or if Miami of Ohio won the game. I'm looking right now. This is just scintillating visual. It was a 30-20 win. Yeah, you couldn't wait. Ohio lost the regular season meeting 30-20 at Miami of Ohio. So now a little bit of revenge with the conference title on the line, bowl berth on the line, conference title on the line. Feels like a lower scoring type game. Just, I really like that Miami of Ohio defense. Who knows if Ohio is going to be able to move the ball. What was the what's the total here?
44
and a half indoors. So the conditions really won't be a factor. 44 and a half Miami of Ohio. Like I said, one and a half, two. I'd look at playing the under, and I know these MAC games have been ugly in the elements, and that has really kind of led to some of the lower scoring games. But I would look at playing under in this game, because I do respect that Miami Ohio defense.
I'll say this. I know a lot of bookmakers in Vegas and a lot of local bookmakers around this country. If you want to extend the longevity of your account, just make a big bet on the MAC game. Because we don't really know what's going to happen. Come on. Does anybody really have an edge on the MAC title game? This is the rule. No.
Parlay it with the Sun Belt game, too.
This is the roulette of conference championship games. Nobody knows what's happening in the MAC. From a number standpoint, let me play the numbers game. I've got Miami, Ohio, 107, Northern, 102. So on a neutral, I would make Miami 5. I have no belief in those numbers. You throw the numbers out at 4 p.m. in the MAC championship.
Go Wong teaser. Western Kentucky +9.5, Ohio +8. There you go.
The local bookie will be very happy if you tease the MAC game. If he sees the MAC game tease, you keep the account a little bit longer.
Sammy, I just have my pen out. I'm ready for my FCS play of the week. What do you got for me?
I do have one. I wasn't prepared. He's on UC Davis. Let me get the rotation number for you.
Oh, the Aggies. I'm in. I mean, are we going to win any one of these ever again or what? What
do you think? Wow. Is this a real play or a fun play?
Some
fun plays,
yeah.
Right?
I was going to say, if it's a fun play.
Oh, yeah, fun play. Then, you always win the fun plays. Now, I'm just giving Sammy grief because he gets called a nerd on the internet for getting these wrong sometimes.
We're 500 this year, unfortunately. After starting 5-1, we are now 500 on the FCS plays. I texted the guy, I said, what are you doing differently? He said nothing. So 308-934 UC Davis.
Ooh, Illinois State.
Minus 6.5.
Illinois State Redbirds, right? The Redbirds?
Yep.
All right. Here we go. A little Illinois State UC Davis. Okay, I'm in. You know, I'm all for it. It's a Saturday at 4 p.m. on ESPN Plus. Yes, iPad it is. Let's go.
Somebody blamed you, though, Jeff. They said when you don't bet them, they don't win.
Well, that is true. I forget some weekends to wager on them because they pop, you know, the numbers pop so quick to kick off, and I'm unfortunately
how hard is it to set a reminder? How hard is it to set a calendar reminder, Jeff?
It's very difficult. You know, I can't do that. That's too much work for me. I need an assistant like Sammy has to scrape Purdue Reddit Purdue Reddit posts.
This is the kind of year it's been, though. The sharp FCS guy is like 500. Meanwhile, the bartender, Sammy's buddy, is living in the penthouse, hitting like 870% in the NFL.
I saw Crack. Crack was saying something like even he's been struggling in FCS. And I'm like, well, if he's struggling, it's okay if I could struggle.
That is true, yes.
The only thing I'm going to be struggling with this weekend is I land in Boise at like 12:05 Thursday night into Friday morning. And we're going to have a production meeting at 10 a.m. local. I need to get my you-know-what out of bed early and get over to Goldie's and have some breakfast because they have this unbelievable salmon hash that is just ridiculously good. So Goldie's is the spot for breakfast if you're ever in Boise there, Will.
What is it? Salmon and hash?
Salmon hash.
Wow.
Yes. Instead of corned beef hash, salmon hash.
You got to start tweeting out these pictures. That's what gets the clicks. People want to live vicariously through
corned beef hash.
People want some walking eats with the bear.
It's so good. Before we get out of here quickly, guys, this Lincoln Riley to UCF thing. Is the Bears just like really gonna? Is this really this is out there for a reason, right? Is this for?
Are you reporting this?
No, Bruce Feldman did. But is this like a thing that we have to talk about in the next couple of days? Is he gonna leave USC for UCF?
It'd be a massive pay cut. That's for sure.
I guess. Why is this out there though? Like, what's the purpose of this thing out here?
Why is it out there? Is it a situation where he has his agent putting it out? He's like, I'm fed up with this USC stuff. I want out. And it's kind of a soft landing. You get another Power 5 job. You're in Florida as opposed to California. Still warm weather. Back to the Big 12 where your offense was ridiculously great. Like, I know some people who have ties to USC, and they would not be too disappointed to see Lincoln Riley leave. So it feels kind of like a perfect out for both parties. They both kind of save face. One still gets a job and one kind of gets to hit the reset button with a program hire.
If we're talking coaches, I want to hear all three of your answers. Just a quick one word or one name. Labor Day 2025, who is coaching the Ohio State Buckeyes?
Ryan Day.
Wow.
Here's the thing about firing coaches. If you fire someone,
there
are reports.
Ryan Day.
0% chance.
When you fire a coach, you have to hire someone better. Like, who are you getting? Ryan Day, I'm stealing this from someone else who said
Dan Lanning. Dan Lanning's going to Columbus.
I think Ari Wasserman said this, and it's true. He has lost one game, and that was last weekend, that he shouldn't have lost his entire coaching career at Ohio State. Mm-hmm. Like, the other games he's lost are games you can reasonably understand he lost. Oregon, Michigan, Georgia. Yes, he has to beat Michigan. I get that. And that game plan on Saturday was ridiculously dumb. I kept looking for like, hey, throw the ball at Jeremiah Smith. Hey, big fella, run as fast as you can down the field. Go. And they just didn't do it. So if you fire him, who are you going to hire? You're not hiring Mike Vrabel. You're not hiring Luke Fickell. You're keeping Ryan Day. So I think it's Ryan Day. Unless USC calls. Maybe USC calls Ryan Day and he goes to USC. I don't know. But I think he's there next season.
You think it's because of the money and they don't want to buy him out? Or you think
they
just... I think it's the reason I said.
Money is not a factor.
Okay. You guys are more confident
than me.
Well, okay, Will, if they get rid of Ryan Day, who are they hiring? Like, who's on the list?
I don't know, but if you gave me like Ryan Day versus the field, I'd probably take the field. Maybe I should ask it that way.
Yeah, I think it's going to be Ryan Day. I think they're going to be okay. Good segue, because I think, like, moving on to the playoff, like, I think Ohio State is now being completely overlooked and disregarded as a national championship contender. Yeah, it was an inexcusable loss, and I lost quite a bit of money going FESBA Purdue style money line on the Buckeyes last week. But now you get the extra time off. You're going to be hosting a game. You're going to be favored in that game, and then as long as you win that game, you're going to get either a warm weather or an indoor game in the quarters, and then potentially the same. Look, this is still a team that went to Eugene, lost by a point, easily could have won the game, beat Penn State in state college, didn't allow an offensive touchdown, beat the ever-living you-know-what out of Indiana, was never a game. This is still a really good team. And now the pressure is, I don't want to say off of them, because, yeah, they did lose to Michigan. Maybe you could say the pressure might still be on them now that they have to win a title. But they don't have that Michigan helmet game over their shoulder. This could be a situation with the extra rest now, no bad weather, or maybe there's some adjustments done on the offensive side of the ball where they finally decide, hey, we just can't run, we can't throw these outs, and they get the ball. That was the most inexcusable thing about the game last week, was just how Jeremiah Smith did not get a touch. He's the best player on your offense. You need to get him the ball. And maybe now they just kind of throw caution to the wind and say, screw it. Yeah. We're throwing the ball as much as we can. So, like, am I crazy with this viewpoint, Will? Like, thinking that Ohio State in the long run, as crazy as it sounds, might be better off not having to play Oregon this week, get the extra time off, get a playoff home game?
No, it's not crazy. I mean, it's a little similar to, remember, it was a couple years ago, they lost to Michigan, and they made a kick against Georgia, and they blew that game 100 different ways. I had them, I think, 14-1. Yeah. Man, they would have killed TCU. No, I don't think you're crazy. I don't think there's value in terms of their number. They're still one of the short shots. If it makes you feel better, you probably would have lost a lot more money if I had showed you, hey, ahead of time, this is going to be the Michigan quarterback's stat line for the game. You probably would have bet even more. 9 of 16, Michigan, 62 yards, two picks, and you lose that game. That's incredible.
And they're going to score 13 points.
Oh, brutal.
It's so bad for Ohio State right now. Arizona State fans are like, we want the Buckeyes. Like, that's how bad it is right now. Did I tell you how I felt about Arizona State, by the way, earlier in the show? I'm not kidding. I have guys with pitchforks in their profiles saying we would beat Ohio State. No, you wouldn't.
No, you wouldn't.
Stop. Stop with that. All that said, some teams, Jeff, and some weird way, like Reggie Miller, Patrick Ewing, couldn't beat the 90s Bulls. The Twins could never beat the Yankees. Ryan Day just can't figure out Michigan.
Yeah.
But I like him against basically every other school in the country.
Yep.
Yeah. I do think it's worth talking about, like, Will Howard, right? I mean, you mentioned the year they lost to Georgia, right? Will, in the play. I mean, that was CJ Stroud, though, right? And that was a different quarterback to Will Howard. And yeah, he might have been dinged up on Saturday. I think people don't think he was 100%. But in these games, he played well against Oregon. He played okay against Penn State, that pick six, and they kind of shut the offense after that. And then obviously in this game, he didn't play well. And Ohio State's offensive line is a problem. If you run up against a Tennessee Bear, which I think you're projecting, right, that them play Tennessee, I think it is. Is that what you projected?
No, it could be.
Alabama.
That's the game right now. Yeah.
Alabama.
That'll change after the title games.
Their offensive line is a problem. It's a problem. And I do think that they're going to at least physically be able to bounce back and play in the playoff. But emotionally, I mean, this is four straight years of this now, right? I mean, Ryan Day looks so shell-shocked after the game. I know people are getting on him for not breaking up the fights or whatever else, but I mean, he looked like, and he said before the game, like, what, his parent passing and beating Michigan are the two most important, like, two worst things ever, losing to Michigan, his parent passing,
he's
something like that, right,
Bear?
Yeah, like, and so, like, you lost that game. You look like he lost a family member. Like, he was, and so.
It really affects his family, the pressure there. I can tell you that.
So how do you, so, like, I just think it's emotionally very hard to bounce back. They might beat a bad team in round one. But when they get to some of these better SEC teams and Big Ten teams, it's going to be hard, in my opinion, with the way Will Howard's playing on their offensive line to really play up to expectations. Like, yes, they're very talented. They could certainly win a championship. But right now, I wouldn't put money on them to do so.
I'm certainly a lot of storylines still to play out, a lot of games to play out to determine ultimately what's going to happen. But I think we all have kind of are assuming that Alabama is going to get in. And if it's either going to be Alabama and SMU or Alabama and Clemson, should Clemson win the ACC? A lot of seeding scenarios to play out as well. But guys, appreciate it as always. Good luck this weekend, and look forward to doing it again next week when we actually have some playoff matchups in the new 12-team bracket.
Another great Gamaguchi. I hope you guys got a lot of good information there. We got the UC Aggies Bear this weekend, the FCS play. It's going to hit, I know. I'm going to wager on it so we know it's going to hit. Let's talk about our best bets presented by DraftKings Sportsbook. I'm going with the first half under in Atlanta, under 23.5 between Georgia and Texas. A couple reasons here at Bear. I think both teams are going to go in this game thinking, let's have our quarterback not screw it up. They're going to run the football, to protect the football. Texas offensive line worries me. Georgia can't run the ball. Getting in third down situations, not where they want to be, right? So kind of just an easy game plan early on, sort of easing the things. Big game for both these teams. Plus, again, Texas schedule. They haven't played a lot of teams like Georgia. And so how are they going to feel that physicality of playing that game again after, you know, 6-7 weeks later? So I like the under here as both teams fill each other out. They both want to run the football, protect their quarterback, take shots when possible. Defenses reign supreme in this game. Plus, we mentioned earlier, Texas sort of underperforms their expected point total each and every week. Give me the under in the first half of this game, 23.5 in Atlanta.
Yeah, I think we're expecting a lot of unders. I know your fade, another fade of yours is the Penn State team total under against Oregon as well. We both expect a low scoring game there. Yeah. Kind of alluded to Penn State's offensive struggles. Four of the last six top 10 opponents, one or zero offensive touchdowns. So we'll see if that holds true there. My best bet of the week presented by DraftKings Sportsbook. I am taking Clemson plus the 2.5.
Yeah.
We talked about this game in the gambling group chat as well. I think the Clemson defense, those bodies, it's just not going to be fun up front for SMU to face. I think Mafa and Klubnik and those young Clemson wide receivers are going to give SMU some problems. I do like this in essentially a home game for the Tigers here in Charlotte. And you could probably, if you're looking to be a little frisky and you want a little bit of a risk involved, we think SMU, if they lose, are out and Alabama will go. So instead of taking Clemson plus 2.5, you could find your best number on a no for Clemson to make the college football playoff. They're plus 280 out there. There's some places that are north of $3. So find your best number on SMU potentially to miss the playoff, and you could probably tie that in there as well.
Yeah, I am with you on Clemson SMU Bear. I look, if Clemson wins this game, SMU wins this game, bravo to them. But I just think they haven't played a team like Clemson in years. And I know Clemson lost last weekend. So it's just a playoff. Losing a rivalry game, having a chance to playoff.
Right.
Doesn't happen very often, but 12-team playoff, it does.
And I get it, but you know how Dabo is. Dabo will have these guys wound up, little old Clemson. We can't make the playoff after the year that they've had. He will have these guys motivated and ready to go. So that's all we got for this week. Kicked around a lot of stuff. We'll be back again next week. But thank you to everyone for watching us on FS1, watching us on YouTube, downloading us wherever you get your podcast, Apple, Spotify, wherever else. Make sure you subscribe to the YouTube Bear Bets channel. Make sure you hit that series recording on FS1 for the Bear Bets podcast show as well. You know the schedule by now. College football on Wednesday, NFL on Thursday, Bruce and the Bear on Friday. Probably change up a little bit come postseason time. Columns throughout the week for college football and NFL picks for myself and Jeff and Sammy, Patrick Everson as well. And that's about it. And there's always one thing that I want you all to remember. Take away, if you're taking away one thing in this podcast, remember, the less you bet, the more you lose when you win.